Barely a century ago, this rough terrain was considered the home of what Western anthropologists called the wildest tribes in the Philippine archipelago. Today, roads cut through the country and many of the so-called wild tribes have been assimilated into the mainstream. But deep in the mountains, something does remain of a fascinating tribal culture. Where in the Philippines? The cross of Christianity has long done battles with the more ancient religions of this land, thus providing the province with a mixed heritage of symbols. But while the cross and the crescent rule over the province, the animists have only one symbol of their faith, the forests and jungles of the mountain ranges. Where in the Philippines? They are the Mandayas, the people of the mountains. In their dances, their customs, their finery, and their costumes, they give us a glimpse of an ancient tribal kingdom pushed further into the mountains by centuries of encroaching religions. Perhaps the most meaningful symbol of the Mandayas' continued existence is the dagmay weaving of the women. In the ancient symbols and colors, in the time-consuming practice that weaves together warp and weft, we see a people's heritage being passed on in a world that is continuously changing. Welcome to Davao Oriental, the Davao that very few Filipinos know of or have visited. On this edition of Travel Time, we venture far from the Davao that is familiar and comforting to travelers, to go to Davao Oriental, the Davao of the Mandayas. At the turn of the century, the noted anthropologist Fay Cooper Cole wrote his landmark work, The Wild Tribes of the Davao Gulf. In this book, he documented the cultures that animate the Davao landscape, the Bagobos, the Manobos, and the Mandaya. To read this book today is to discover just how many of our indigenous cultural communities have lost so much in the race for national integration. There is very little left of what is wild, either in the landscape or the culture. With the loss of forests and mountain covers, so much has been altered in these people's lives, and yet we find a valiant struggle to adapt to change while proclaiming their sense of identity, their sense of being Mandaya. I'm Susan Kala Medina. Join me in this exciting adventure into the wilds of Davao Oriental as Travel Time goes into the heart of the Mandaya. It should be safe to assume that Davao Oriental is the least known and least explored of the three Davaos. Bounded on the west by Davao del Norte, on the east by the Davao Gulf, the province is more mountainous than her sisters. The flatlands and plateaus are marked by extensive swamplands, which are fed by the rivers Sumlog, Mayo, and Katiil. Davao Oriental was once a part of the old Caraga province, established in 1609 by the Spanish. It remained thus until in 1898, when in the advent of the American rule, Davao became a district of the Mindanao province, along with Cotabato, Lanao, Zamboanga, and Agusan. Davao was wrested from this homogeneous Muslim province in 1967 when it became a separate and independent province composed of 11 municipalities and 179 barangays. As with most of Mindanao, settlers from all over Luzon and Visayas declared an open season on Davao Oriental's rich, water-fed plains and coastal areas.
The settlers' culture is based on agriculture and fishing. The land is given to rice, corn, copra, and abaca. While the coastal areas have supported generations of fishermen. The original inhabitants of Davao Oriental are the Mandaya, a people of Malay-Indonesian stock who speak an Eastern Mindanao language. The Mandaya, along with their subgroup, the Mansaka, share many cultural similarities with their neighbors in the extremely mountainous southern regions facing the Pacific coast. And like their animist neighbors, the Bagobo, the Manobo, and the Bukidnon, the Mandaya have been living in the mountains, pushed there by the arrival and spread of Islam. In this century, it is not Islam, but the constant arrival of settlers that pushes the Mandaya and the other indigenous animist groups of Mindanao deeper and deeper into the fast dwindling forests.
When we return, we marvel at the natural beauty of the province.
The ride to Manay from Mati allowed us to glimpse settler life in the more remote parts of the province. And as we drove away from the capital, it did seem that the ways of the settlers were now beginning to meld with an older lifestyle. Manay, we were to have our first meeting with the Mandaya in a school supported and run by the National Commission on Culture and the Arts. The school promotes and preserves the material arts of the Mandaya. Here, weavers and embroiderers work on the looms, creating yards of the famous Dagmay fabric of the tribe and teaching the art to lowland Mandaya children in the town's public schools. From Manay, we drove to Caraga, the old coastal town from which the entire portion of southern Mindanao once derived its name. The town's importance has much to do with the fact that it was among the first towns founded by the Spanish. Thus, Caraga was once described as the real capital of Mindanao. Not only was it an important economic and defense center, it was also the seat of Christianity in Muslim Mindanao, ministered to by the Recollects. Wonder why such an important town should have a church dating from only 1886. Constant raids and battles with the Muslims may have prevented the Recollect fathers from building a grand edifice of stone. They blessed Caraga However, with the name Region de Gente Animosa, the region of spirited and courageous people. Caraga being a Hispanized form of Calag, the native word for soul. We continued from Caraga and entered the mountains at Barangay Lamyawan. We left Lamyawan in a tough road warrior, a 3/4-ton truck that looked like it had seen better days, but proved amazingly adept at navigating the steep turns up the mountains. Our destination was the old village of Lucatan, nestled amidst the jungles of the mountain range. We experienced the thrill of forging a river, only to find out that we had gotten as far as the truck would take us. From here on, the 2-hour trip was made on motorcycle or on foot. Up through the mountains, we gradually entered the traditional world of the Mandaya. Blackened stretches of Kaingin peeked at us through mist-covered forests. Finally, we reached our destination, the Mandaya village of Lucatan. Although the poblacion is now known in Mati as Barangay Pichon, the Mandaya inhabitants still refer to the area as Lucatan, its old Mandaya name. The Mandaya are traditionally slash-and-burn farmers who grow corn in their kaingins. It is a hard life that many of them still cling to, even as forests begin to diminish. When a kaingin is first planted, the community gathers to perform a ritual that asks the spirits of the land for their benediction. The Mandaya build their kaingins with what the modern mind will applaud as an environmental approach. Only a predetermined amount of jungle is burned away. Then the community arranges the bitik, the field layout that ensures full use of the cleared ground. The Tagbinihan ritual is performed after the layout has been determined. In it, the farmer brings a piece of live coal from his own home to the field. It is used to light a ceremonial spirit torch that calls the spirits to witness. Then the farmer brings the sacrificial chicken whose blood he sprinkles over the land. After the ritual, the planting begins. Instead of plowing, the grains are sown and then covered to be cultivated and weeded by the farmer. The first sowing of the seeds ends with a communal feast in the field.
Kinakailangan daw nilang magdasal kay Tagamaling dahil si Tagamaling daw ang may-ari ng biyaya ng ating lupa.
Sino si Tagamaling?
Yun ang gawon. Di ko makita.
Sino si Tagamaling?
Di ko makita.
Sino kuno si Tagamaling?
At tumagawyas ang tungkuan. Bod-bod. Awal sa kapangkangan sa bukid.
Si Tagamaling daw ay hindi natin makikita at karaniwang nakatira sa yung kahoy na bod-bod.
Ganyan ang yayin.
Yun ang kanilang kinikilalang Panginoon ng may kapangyarihan po.
Hunting is still a common activity among the Mandayam men folk. In their hunts, the men use a variety of traditional instruments such as the sumpitan, a blowpipe, the busog, the bow and arrow, and the litag, the trap for birds and monkeys. In their hunting and planting, the Mandaya have long known the value of conservation. They take only what is needed from the jungle and return what they take. A Mandaya male who has cut down a tree from the forest for his house or for firewood will immediately replant a sapling. It is a ritual that thanks the forest and its gods, just as it ensures the cycle of continuance. In Lucatan, ritual marks the daily cycle of Mandaya life. And here, the similarities with other Mindanao hill people, like the Bagobo and the Manobo, become even more marked. The duality of the male and female were best exemplified in the cults of the warrior and the priestess, the Bagani and the Babaylan. As with the other hill tribes, the warrior cult was gradually lost in the 20th century. All that has been retained is the cult and the figure of the priestess known among the Mandaya as the Balyan. A healer and a communicator with the spirit world, the Balyan is called upon to officiate at the numerous ceremonies that attend traditional Mandaya life. Aided by her special guardian, the unseen Abyan, and by an apprentice Balyan, who supports and ministers to her on her difficult journeys into the spirit world, the Balyan is still an important presence in Mandaya life. In Lucatan, a woman of about 50 years old fell into a trance in a ceremony held to welcome us to the village. Here is a world that is still governed by the spirits of nature, the spirits of the ancestors, the spirits of the gods, and the spirits too would animate their music and their arts as we would discover.
From the heart of the forest and the mountain into the heart of the Mandaya village when we return.
Was spent listening to an impromptu concert of Mandaya music. First in the evening's repertoire was the Bayok. A chanted performance that is common among both the animist and Islamized tribes of Mindanao. What distinguishes the Mandaya Bayok is the use of the high tonal pitch that marks their everyday speech patterns. While other tribes may know the Bayok as a song to be performed by the individual, the Mandaya perform it in pairs, with one partner singing an answer or continuation to the performance previous. The musical instruments of the Mandaya stress individual virtuosity rather than ensemble playing. The suding or juice harp is played here with both speed and brilliance by Dianon Tilakan. The kudlong is the distant cousin of the noble kutyapi, a humbler instrument that relies only on two strings. Drum that accompanies the balyans, dancing and seances. Bunabon is the flute of the bamboo.
Mm-hmm.
Mandaya dance is again an echo of similar steps performed all throughout the Mindanao highlands. The quick shuffling steps, the arms bent at the elbows, the unstopping pounding of bare feet on the earth. The steps are seen in the trance-inducing steps of the Babalyan. More joyous gandang, a sort of mandaya free for all, in which the members of the community dance in close proximity to each other. So far, we have seen nothing that strikes us as distinctly mandaya. Musical instruments and forms, dances and social offices are akin to those of the Bagobo, the Manobo, and the Bukidnon. Indeed, these similarities point to the shared culture and background of these tribes. And yet, these groups are most different and most striking in their costumes and their weaving. We explore the dream world of the Mandaya weavers when we return. In her landmark work on indigenous textiles, Habi, Marian Pastor Roses identifies the common tradition that once again binds the Manobo, the Bagobo, the Tiboli, the Blaan, and the Mandaya, the tradition of producing reserve-dyed, plain-woven abaca textiles. These highly polished tricolor abaca fabrics were distinguished by the black, brown, red, and ochre fields juxtaposed against sections of undyed abaca. All the indigenous groups collectively describe the reserve dyed techniques through a variant of the root word bed. Among the Mandaya, the term is badbad, the clumps of fibers that will soon be ready for dyeing and weaving. The abaca plant is very much suited to the multi-cropping that the Mandaya practice. Paksi refers to the process of extracting the raw fibers from the abaca plant. Lubok is the process of pounding the abaca fibers to make them softer and more pliant. After that, the weavers tie the threads together in a process called sugpon. Salik describes the process of spinning the threads together and then grouping them in order of size and number. And then the process of reserve dyeing begins. Puyupok refers to the process of soaking the fibers in red or black dye. The resultant fibers are called badbad. Then the threads are arranged on the loom. Already, the weavers have planned their designs before the actual process of habol, or weaving, begins. And it is a matter of individual pride for the weavers that they are able to cluster as many as 100 warp threads into the overall layout of the loom. The finished fabric is called the dagmai. And the most special of dagmai fabrics, the ones that clustered 100 warp threads to produce the most complex designs, are called sangatus. Tradition dictated that all weaving be supervised by the balyan. For the priestess was the archetypal weaver, just as she was the archetypal healer and medium. Another tradition holds that the designs for the dagmai be the product of dreams and instructions from the spirits. Thus, the realm of Mandaya design evokes a dream world of motifs and colors. In the oldest specimens, the details are minuscule, intricate successions of motifs. Newer works blow up the design to show anthropomorphic elements, as well as motifs derived from flora and fauna, magical men and frogs, crocodiles with human beings in their entrails, intricate tendrils, all dramatically posed against dark maroon and ochre fields, the signature colors of the bedbed tradition, and dedicated to the goddess of weaving herself.
Ang kwento ng dagmay about tagamaling, yung tagamaling mismo ang tumuturo sa kanila. Nananaginip kasi sila kung paano paggawa ng dagmay. Tapos,
mag-weave sila, anong ginagawa nila bago?
Pumapatay sila ng manok at saka baboy bago sila magsimula ng kanilang trabaho. Para offering nila kay tagamaling, para hindi sila mapagalitan. Every weaver sa kanila, iba-iba silang design. Mm-hmm. Hindi magkapareho yung kanilang design. Yung mga design ng dagmay, human figure, crocodile, at saka yung flower. Uh-huh. Tapos yung iba naman is linangaw, limba, walo, yung duwaw.
Another tradition shared with the Bagobo, Tiboli, and Manobo is the craft of embroidery. But while the other tribes are known for embroidery on abaca, the Mandaya are known for their embroidery on cotton. The blouses of the women and the men are studies in dense, compacted design fields, alternating with solid bands of color. The entire costume of the Mandaya female is built around the dramatic mix of textures and designs. The shiny abaca skirt with its crocodiles and humans, set against the embroidered blouses, a bloom with the crosses and X's on the arms. The alternating bands of carabao horn and white shell bangles. Then, the spray of beads and silver discs at the breast, topped by the striking and modern hairstyle of bangs and ponytails, and finished off by the blackened and filed teeth that complete the Mandaya look. While the weaving traditions may bind the Mandaya with their neighbors, the total look, the fastidious mix of symbols, the overall density of the design is what sets them apart. The dagmai, not only a process or a product, but a means of continuance.
In these mountains, we discover a whole new way of looking at things, a world of symbols and myths, moving in a continuum of music and chanted poetry. When we return, we listen to other voices moving into another continuum of change.
I guess I think worldwide, I think it's existing nowadays that people have to get in touch with the roots of the individual. Ngayon, may kasabihan na ang taong hindi marunong lumingon sa kanyang pinagagalingan, hindi mararating ang kanyang pinaroon niya. Sa liwakayan yan eh.
Our short stay with the Mandaya community of Lucatan told us many things about the culture. But the most striking fact is born out of our conversations with the young Mandaya men and women who have gone to school and who have seen both advantages and the disadvantages of being Mandaya in a world where ethnic identity means little or nothing.
Like what I've said a while ago, we have to pass it from generation to generation. We have to teach our children, the younger Mandaya, ang love na mo kailangang i-preserve yun na mo para sa mong binikan, and then to our children and to our brothers and sisters.
Sadly, the truth about the Mandaya is that, like most other indigenous people, they have become marginalized members of society. And yet, there is much to be proud of, just as there is much to be desired.
In getting educated, it was not emphasized that it does not disqualify you from being a member of the Mandaya tribe. Because being a Mandaya runs in the being. It's in the blood, not in the books. Now, there is also that sort of identity crisis among them, wherein they wanted to more or less be identified with the elite or the upper crust of the society. So in order for them to be accepted in that echelon, I think they have to cast away their being Mandaya.
Kapag kami ay nakikipag-ugnayan sa iba't ibang mga katutubo ng Pilipinas, ang isang lagi kong nagiging reaksyon ay ito. Sayang at parang unti-unti nang nawawala ang kanilang kultura. Ngunit ang kultura ay hindi nawawala. Ito ang natutunan namin sa mga Mandaya ng Davao Oriental. Ito ay nagbabago lamang, nakikibagay sa panahon at sa iba't ibang suliranin na dumarating. At nakita natin na marami ang nananatiling dalisay at maganda sa kultura ng mga Mandaya. In the end, culture is not a piece of dagmay, a song, a dance. These are just manifestations of culture. It is the life in these communities that is culture, and it is the survival of the marginalized Mandaya that constitutes the most valuable cultural artifact. We hope our journey tonight has awakened similar observations, similar emotions in you, in our ability to empathize with the joys and anxieties of the Mandaya. We discover our heart in theirs. I'm Susan Calo Medina from the heart of Mandaya land, saying huwag maging dayuhan sa sariling bayan.